BibleChristian.org. Hello, this is Gary Pinnell, and I'd like to welcome you to our Bible study today on Luke chapter 17. And as we start today, I want to encourage you that there is tremendous revivals happening around the world, and many souls are getting saved in many places. And so I encourage you with that. Yesterday, I looked at online 10 different countries that were increasing in Christianity. In Iran, there, for example, there are over 1 million Christians last year received the Lord. Or 1 million people became Christians, I should say, and received the Lord as their own personal Lord and Savior. All their meetings have to be held in secret. But when they're raided, they will take pictures of everyone. And of course, there could be consequences for the people that are having prayer there together. But also, the pastors are taken to jail. But that doesn't stop them. The church is still growing. There's many times Jesus is appearing to people in dreams and visions. And then also in northern Brazil, I was looking at yesterday how that they baptized 30,000 people in northern Brazil in the little villages and places that are very hard to get to. You have to get there by motorboat, basically. But they're looking forward to baptizing 40,000 people this year. That's their goal, as I remembered. And so we can praise the Lord that he's working, and in spite of all the darkness that we have here, and another attempt on our former president's life yesterday. But again, he was protected. I believe the Lord is helping in this election, and that we just keep praying for our leadership. But right now, let's go back and to Luke chapter 17, and we'll see where the church started through Jesus, of course, who said he would build his church, and he did. And he has for 2,000 years now. He has kept his church going. And we're going to see at the beginning what it was like and what it is like now. And as we looked earlier at the book of Acts, is to see the church still expanding into different parts of the world today. Well, Luke wrote the first part of his writing, and Luke 1 kind of is the book of Luke, and then you have the book of Acts, which is not only a history of the church, but it is a blueprint for the church. It is a history of the church, but it is a blueprint for us today. And the reason I say that, in northern Brazil, the same things that happened in Acts, a lot of the same things are taking place there. The blind are receiving their sight. The lame are healed. And praise the Lord for that. Now, I encourage you, if you have an opportunity at all, to get on Christian Broadcast Network, CBN, on your cell phone and on your computer and so on, and you'll find out that God is still doing the same miracles today that he did in these days that we're going to be reading about, but in some cases even greater than what they saw during the Bible times. And so CBN, hello, Esther, the Lord bless you, sister, and also Pastor Emmanuel. We're looking at chapter 17, so let's go ahead and get started there. And it says that, then he said to the disciples, it is impossible that no offenses should come, but woe to him through whom they do come. It would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were drowned in the sea than that he should offend one of these little ones. Take heed to yourselves. If your brother sins against you, rebuke him, and if he repents, forgive him. And if he sins against you seven times in a day, and seven times in a day returns to you saying, I repent, you shall forgive him. Now that's the way God forgives us, isn't it? And the apostles, they thought, if I forgive somebody seven times, be enough. And Jesus said, no, 70 times seven. In other words, there's no limit. And God is like that to us. And so we're to treat our fellow man that way. And I'll tell you, sometimes, we have a lot of things to come, especially as pastors, work in churches, and also as different ministries, anywhere that you're serving the Lord, you're going to be attacked. There are going to be offenses. There's going to be people upset with you. And you just keep on serving the Lord and forgiving them and going on. And that is the way that we need to live the Christian life. And so just a bit of encouragement there. Maybe I don't know if that's encouragement or not, knowing that it's always going to be those spiritual struggles that are taking place. And then it says, and the apostle said to the Lord, increase our faith. Now that's good, isn't it? I like that. So the Lord said, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, be pulled up by the roots and be planted in the sea, and it would obey you. And which of you, having a servant plowing or tending sheep, will say to him when he comes in from the field, come at once and sit down to eat? But will he not rather say to him, prepare something for my supper and gird yourself and serve me till I have eaten and drunk, and afterward you will eat and drink? Now, when it says eat, and they're not drunk like that, they're are full, satisfied with what they're drinking and so on. And but the thing that he's pointing out here, does he think that the servant, because he did the things that were commanded him, no, I think not. So likewise you, when you have done all those things which you are commanded, say, we are unprofitable servants. We have done what was our duty to do. All right? As Christians, that's the way we look at our Christian life. God has told us to reach the lost and to help in any way we can to help them grow in the Lord, and that's just our duty. We expect that there will be attacks that come when you're serving the Lord, and they will come. I can tell you that there's attacks in Kenya and India and things that way beyond what you thought would be possible. And at the same token, they continue on. We have to continue on. That's our duty, to continue, even when it seems like things are happening that really hurt. And I think that I'm supposed to share some of this so you can know how to pray. But in Kenya and the work there, and with one of the people that we fellowship with, there was evidently a person who claimed to be a believer came in, and had hung himself inside where the church building was. And you can imagine the stir that that caused. But then people being superstitious think, well, it's the pastor's fault that this happened. And so many of the people have left the church and only a few have remained. Well, that's an attack of Satan. And that to be done is you say, well, oh, that's a really strong attack. Yes, that is a fiery attack of the enemy. But you have to go on and serve the Lord and encourage your brother there in Kenya to continue helping this brother in the ministry that is struggling right now. And another time, like the pastor Gabriel there in Kenya, and one of the ladies that was a worker in the church and faithful, loved the Lord, she was having her baby and having it at the hospital because she was having some problems, which is more often than not probably theirs in the hospital. But anyway, they had to do cesarean section, and then they did something wrong evidently, and she bled to death. The baby is still alive today. But the thing is that then people think, oh, well, there's something wrong with the pastor because this happened. It wasn't his fault in any way. And the Lord took her home to heaven to be with him, but it was not the pastor's fault. Did you see how Satan will attack and in any way that he can? But then we just need to be faithful to the Lord through it all. And they are being that. Now, Kathy, the Lord bless you. And we're in Luke chapter 17, and we're down to verse 10. Now we'll look at verse 11 there and continue on in this chapter. I haven't looked at how many verses yet, but I'll take a glance at that. Okay, 37 verses today. So we go to verse 11. Now it happened as he went to Jerusalem that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. Then as he entered a certain village, there met him 10 men who were lepers, who stood afar off. And they lifted up their voice and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. So when he saw them, he said to them, go, show yourselves to the priest. And so it was that as they went, they were cleansed. So they had a step of faith that they had to take. And they had to stay at distance because in those days, if you had leprosy, you would have to say, unclean, unclean. Jesus, that didn't bother him. He had laid his hands on the lepers and so on. But here, so he sent them to the priest to go show themselves. So they took the step of faith, all 10 of them. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, returned and with a loud voice glorified God and fell down on his face at his feet, giving him thanks. And he was a Samaritan. So Jesus answered and said, were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? Were there not any found who returned to give glory to God except this foreigner? So there were evidently 9 of them were Jewish, no doubt. And then it's only the foreigner, the Samaritan, which was, they considered half Jewish and half Gentile. And he came back to give thanks to God. And he said to him, arise, go your way. Your faith has made you well. All right. So it's an interesting thing, isn't it? That 10 were healed, but only one came back. And that one was a Samaritan. I think that we need to be thankful for all that we have, wherever we are. And sometimes, you know, we don't always thank the Lord. I do try to thank the Lord for everything. We're, you know, we have many, many privileges as Christians. We have so much to look forward to. And yes, there is persecution that comes. There are people that will make fun of us. There are people that will try to bring down the ministry. Satan will attack in ways like we just talked about and have somebody commit suicide, or and that's not of the Lord, as you know. And then someone died through in the hospital and that sort of thing. But you know what? We're still going to serve the Lord. We went even last night to it's not a wake, but it was a place where there was a viewing of a body of a brother that had passed away, and cirrhosis of the liver, but and so he's just 60 years old, I believe. But the thing is that before he was saved, he had, you know, drank a lot, I suppose, and that's cirrhosis of the liver as a result. But the thing is that he knew the Lord Jesus Christ as his Savior. I performed their wedding. And I always counsel people before that. The first counseling session is on salvation. And he was sure of his salvation in Jesus Christ. They went to, they were Catholics before, but they started going to an evangelical church in the area. And so I can assure his wife that they had a wonderful time since they were married. But the thing is that now he's with the Lord. And one day we'll go to be with him, but he is doing just fine. You know, and so there's things like this we can encourage people with in spite of the fact that there are the hardships for us. But with Christ, he will help us through every situation. And so we need to be thankful, though. And not all of us are thankful as we should be. Should thank the Lord for salvation first and foremost, but then for healing. And what he did here was that sometimes the people that we think would least appreciate are the ones that appreciate it most. And so now when verse 19, he said, and he said to him, arise, go your way, your faith has made you well. Verse 20, now when he was asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, he answered them and said, the kingdom of God does not come with observation. Now, you could think of this as like organization, because some people think that the church is an organized body on the earth. It's not. It's not like the Roman Catholics think or the Eastern Orthodox think that it's organized the way that they think that it's organized. It's not. The kingdom of God is spiritual. We are living stones. In other words, we're part of the body. We're part of the temple and the bride of Christ. But it's not something that is on the earth, that is earthly, that is organized like a business. It's not. We're supposed to do things decently and in order, that's true. But that doesn't mean there will be a pope that we look to or a hierarchy that we look to. All born-again believers are priests in the body of Christ. And it is invisible, the kingdom of God on the earth now. Now in the 1,000 years, it will be visible. There will be, Jesus will be the head of the kingdom of God on the earth at that time. But right now, it's not an organized body. You cannot organize like something like 2 billion people that claim to be Christians in the world, and no doubt probably half of those are truly born again, but only God knows. But it's not organized that way. God is the one who is at the head of the church. God is the one who helps us in our spiritual lives and in the church that are born again believers, and that's how he works. And so it doesn't come with observation. Like I said, at this time, in 1,000 years, yes, it will. Nor will we say, see here or see there, for indeed the kingdom of God is within you. And we need to understand that. It's very important, because people go around trying to organize a world body or something, and no, it's not that. It's invisible, because the Holy Spirit is invisible, but he's inside of us, and we can see the results of it, like the wind, Jesus said. Then he said to the disciples will come, the days will come when you will desire to see one of the days of the Son of Man, and you will not see it. So his time on the earth was limited, and they will say to you, look here or look there. Do not go after them or follow them. Even today, there's people saying, oh, I am Christ, and people go out and give their money to him and so on. No, that is not of God. All right, when he comes, be the rapture of the church first, and then he will come and set up his earthly kingdom on the earth at that time. But for as the lightning that flashes out of one part under heaven shines to the other part under heaven, so also the Son of Man will be in his day. When he comes to set up his kingdom, there's not going to be any doubts about it. Oh, he's out there in the woods, or you know, he's over there in the desert. Nope, every eye will see him as he sets up his earthly kingdom on this earth. But first, he must suffer many things and be rejected by this generation, that generation of the Jews, because of the false religious leaders. And then they infested the rest of the nation, and they turned away from Jesus and did not receive him at that time. But in the future, they will receive him as a nation. And so verse 26, and as it was in the days of Noah. What's it going to be like in the last days? It will be also in the days of the Son of Man. What was it like in the days of Noah? It was violence. It was immorality. The believers intermarrying with the unsaved, with the wicked, and taking wives just without continuing on in the faith. And so falling away. They ate and they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark, and the flood came and destroyed them all. So even though they saw the ark building, and they knew that there, God told Noah that there was 120 years left, and Noah was building the ark during that whole time with his family. But when the rain started and the door was closed, it happened very quickly. Likewise, as it was also in the days of Lot. So in Lot, there was homosexuality. They ate, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they built. And they just thought, well, it's all going to go on like it's always gone on. We can go on in our sin and so on. But on that, the day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. And of course, there's evidence of that around the Dead Sea. And there's been excavations and so on, where they've seen the cities that have been covered
And so, this area of Sodom and Gomorrah, even so will it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed. It's interesting that Billy Graham gave a statement when he was alive that if God doesn't judge this generation, that he would have to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah because we are becoming very immoral and homosexual, even as Sodom was in those days. And that's true of many, many countries. And it's been going rampant in a lot of countries today. So it will be like the immorality and violence of Noah's time and of the homosexuality of Sodom and Gomorrah. And so then it says, verse 30, so even so will it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed. In that day, he who is on the housetop and his goods are in the house, let him not go down to take them away. And likewise, the one who is in the field, let him not turn back. Remember Lot's wife, as she turned back to look at Sodom, they couldn't leave that place. And so, even though she was out of the city was still in her heart, the wickedness that she wanted to be a part of. And so she looked back. Well, no, we're not to look back to sin once the Lord has saved us. And there are two views as to the Lord usually gives a near view and a far view. In this case, the near view would be when Titus destroyed Jerusalem, and the houses and the people there, between 1 million and 2 million people in Jerusalem, were killed at that time. But now, in the future, the midpoint of the tribulation, there will be this type of thing happening again, where the city will be attacked, and God will have to protect them as they flee out of the city to Petra and other places the Bible talks about. And so that's Jesus is giving both, and as he's talking about this, and then he says, and even so will it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed. So just before Jesus comes back to this earth, it's going to be like that. And so they have to realize that they want to know, so he's telling them. And that day, he was on the housetop and so on. And so they're going to run in Jerusalem as the Antichrist is going to attack them, and because they don't take the mark of the beast, and they realize that he's an imposter, and that when he breaks the covenant with them and stands up in the temple to have the people worship him, and instead of the God of heaven. And so just remember that Jesus said that this is the way it's going to be before he comes back. And we see all these things falling into place. Whoever seeks to save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life will preserve it. Those pastors in Iran that are having Bible studies and leading people to the Lord and taken away to jail, they're losing their life as far as the world is concerned. But actually, whoever loses his life will preserve it. And so the Lord will give them something special in heaven for suffering for him and giving up this earthly life. I tell you, in that night there will be two men in one bed. The one will be taken and the other will be left. Now, here I believe that he's specifically talking about, because he said that when the Son of Man comes, he's talking about when Jesus comes back to this earth. And people confuse this. Oh, this is a picture of the rapture. No, it's not a picture of rapture. The rapture is different. There the believers are taken into heaven, in the church. But here, when Jesus comes back to the earth after the 7 years tribulation, those that are non-believers in Jesus, they're going to be taken into judgment. And the others that are left are the ones that will go alive into, our believers will go alive into the 1,000-year millennial reign of Christ. And so that there can be children born during that time. And of course, they all believers, it will be only believers that will go into the 1,000-year millennial reign, but they will have children, and those children will have a choice at the end of the 1,000 years if they're going to serve Jesus or Satan when he's released again. Verse 34, I tell you, and that night there will be two men in one bed. The one will be taken away to judgment, in other words, and they'll be killed as Jesus comes back, and the other will be left, the ones that didn't take the mark of the beast. And during the 7 years of tribulation, two women will be grinding together. The one will be taken, the other left. Two men will be in the field. The one will be taken away into judgment, and the other left. And they answered and said to him, where, Lord? So he said to them, wherever the body is, there the eagles will be gathered together. And the meat-eating birds, the carnivorous birds, fowl, and will be gathered from around the earth to the Battle of Armageddon. And where, even as we were reading recently, in Zechariah, that when God comes to, when Jesus comes back and smites the earth with the sword of his mouth, that it says their eyes, so it's like they will melt, and it's like, the description is like they're melting when he judges. And of course their spirit will be taken away into judgment, and their bodies will be left to be eaten by the fowl. So they ask why about this, you know, as far as the coming of the kingdom of the Lord and so on. And so Jesus holds nothing back. He tells them what it's going to be like, because he said that he's going to be rejected by that generation, but he will be received by the generation we believe that we're living in, by the Jews during the midpoint of the tribulation. So hopefully that is helpful, but also to not to lose heart, that those that you're praying for as Jews and so on that aren't saved, I believe that they will be saved, and they will receive Jesus as their Messiah in the time to come. But even right now, we thank the Lord for the revivals that are taking place around the earth. And so with that, we're going to have a closing word of prayer. Father, we just come to you in Jesus' name alone. Thank you that we can serve you in these last days. Thank you that you've told us, excuse me, everything that's going to happen. And that's happening just exactly like you said. So we thank you for your word. And we pray that you'll help us to spread the good news to other people as much as possible. Thank you, Father. By the power of your Holy Spirit, that you will do these things and perform the miracles that you do all the time throughout the earth. Thank you, Father. We pray these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen. All right. Well, we'll see you, God willing, tomorrow. And the Lord bless you, brothers and sisters in Christ. And Judy and Emmanuel and Esther and Kathy and all these that others that my sister Bonnie and others that are getting on at this time. The Lord bless you. Shalom.